I'd like to introduce Kevin Sorbo.
Thank you. This is like a time warp for me. This is very interesting. I actually had to write some notes down because I knew that, I mean, Jeannie tells me, she goes, yeah, I just want you to talk about your life, being born here and then, you know, going through school and then going to the Mound and going to high school and college. And I said, you want me to do that in 30 minutes? I said, really? I don't know anybody can do that with their life in 30 minutes. But it is interesting to be back. It's fun. I try to get back every year. I've been back. I missed last summer. I was pretty busy. I shot 6 movies last year. So it was a busy year for me, and it was a good year, obviously. But I missed it, but I do love coming back. This is a home to me. I mean, I grew up here. I had a wonderful time growing up here. And this time of year, for me, is the best time to be here. Quite frankly, you can keep your winters. I think by about my freshman year in high school, I was like, okay, what am I still here for? And I thought of my Norwegian ancestry, and I said, why did they move from a place that was cold to a place that was cold? They could have picked Florida or Carolina or something like that. But I hate admitting that the year I was born in 58, and I know we're all getting older, but you know, we still don't feel our age. We feel younger than we really are. So that was the year that the house was built in Forest Lane. So everybody, I know there's some people here from that area and good old Dutch Lake. I got wonderful memories of being on Dutch Lake. And I know, yeah. The Moots are here. They drove down from Alex. It's very nice you guys came down. Mark, I've known Mark probably easily the longest of all of my high school mates from the class of 77. And the Schwingers are here as well. And it's a Joe Rohn even showed up, for crying out loud. Joe, it was everyone seen each other. There's other people from my class here I haven't seen since we graduated. And we all need name tags, guys, because we change a little bit. But it's amazing. Great memories of growing up there and going to, I think I was in Shirley Hills for kindergarten. We went there for first year, right? And was Hilltop being built, or was it? It was already built, wasn't it? I'm trying to figure out why we went there for one kindergarten, and then first grade through sixth grade, we were in, we flunked out of Shirley Hills. Okay, that was... Schwingler was there, and he said, they're not good enough to be here, so get them out of here. So I was first through sixth grade. I was at Hilltop, and I mean, the list can go on there with all the memories I got from those grades as well. And then, oh, by the way, we're the Mohawks, okay? It's Mohawks. I'm not that politically correct, and if anybody reads my Facebook, you will find out very quickly that I'm not. I don't fit in Hollywood too well. But it was weird that they changed into it, and I never got the reasons why. Washington Redskins gets a lot. You know, people around the world heard of the Redskins. People around the world don't know Mound. They don't know where we're at. So I don't know. I still fight that thing. I gotta say, one of the I'm like a closet thespian when I was in school because I went to the Guthrie Theater. We had a field trip in fifth grade, and we saw The Merchant of Venice, and it was Shakespeare. And I don't know what the heck these guys were saying, but I was mesmerized by the actors on stage. I was mesmerized, actually, just watching the people being mesmerized, watching. And I remember telling my mom, I said, you know, she said, what do you think of it? I said, Mom, I think I want to be an actor. And she gave me this little pat on the thigh and said, that's nice, dear. So I got one of those mom things. But I kept it to myself because, you know, I was a jock. I loved playing football and basketball and baseball. And it was something I sort of kept to myself because we actually made fun of the kids in the drama classes. But every time we walked by Mr. G's class, they'd go, yeah, it was a bunch of pussies. Like, yeah, a bunch of, what are they doing in there? You know, I kind of check out. And really all the hot girls were in that class too. So I started kind of, you know, screwing around with a little bit when I went to college at Moritz State. Mark went up there, he just went a year, right? Mark went through for a year, then went to Oregon, then he finished up at the U. But I had a great time at Moritz State as well. And I think your parents went there. Weren't you Morehead grads? There you go, another one back. There's more Morehead, really? Wow. Go Dragons. You know, I got two brothers went to Gus Davis, one went to Concordia, and I feel like Tom Cruise in that movie, Risky Business, when he says, I guess it's Illinois State or whatever he's going to. You know, I went to a state college. But great memories going there as well. I got to go back because I had a little flashback here the other day. I was thinking about, we were in the ninth grade when Grandview used to be Grandview Junior. I was seventh, eighth, and ninth graders. And it was after basketball one day, and I can't remember if Mark was there in there too, but we plugged up all the showers. And we flooded the shower room just so we could run and fly on our bellies going across. And I know, it was like we were naked. It's like, that's why I liked acting. No. I remember just one by one, we just stopped and turned because leaning up against the door with the SWAT board was Mr. Mead. And with wet, naked tushes, had to bend over. So you get sued for that today, right? But I'm telling you right now, with the way our school system were going, we need those SWAT boards back in the schoolrooms. I mean, seriously, I see what's going on in education and what's happening to the kids in our country. I actually have the number one after school program. I'm making my principal back there, Mr. Thossenson, very happy, and a couple of the teachers in here. I have the number one after school program in the state of California. It's called the World Fit for Kids. I've been doing it for 18 years. And California, thank you. The California, the Los Angeles Unified School District has a 54% dropout rate, starting as low as the fifth grade. We're able to raise just enough money to keep on average 12,000 kids in our program. It's a 3-hour program dealing with physical fitness. So Mr. Couts will be happy, even though all those years in elementary school, he made us do sit-ups the wrong way. He's actually a neighbor of my mom and dad. My dad passed a couple years ago, but they've been down in Henderson, Nevada. And every time I see him down there, I let him know that, you know, you wrecked my back. You totally wrecked my back. But my program deals with physical fitness the first hour. The second hour, obviously, if you work out, your retention and attention levels will spike. And the third hour, and so we deal with their school problems, whatever they got. So the 12,000 kids we work with in the same school district has a 54% dropout rate. We have a 98% graduation rate and a 67% higher GPA. And I've been to D.C. many times speaking with Congress members and show them what we do, show them the facts, show them everything we got, and all we get is a pat on the back and say, oh, keep it up. And there's no help to move this in other school districts, which is amazing to me. But at least, you know what, I'm doing my little piece. So we're doing something out there. I can't complain too bad. John Schwingler held a little party for us at his house a couple nights ago to see a bunch of my old college mates, which was kind of fun. And he pulled out all these memories from grade school and junior high and high school. And everybody just got around the table and started looking at it. It was just really amazing because it just, like I said, everything just starts flooding back, like MAA football when we were in fifth and sixth grade, the Cowboys at the old Hador Field, which is now, Joe Rohn lives there now. He lives, you know, next to the old Dairy Queen, which the Wikis used to own and all that. But it was neat to look at this. He's got a lot of stuff that I don't have. And I said, you better make me copies because I'd like to have it just for the memories of it all. But it was, by the way, I went to St. John's Lutheran Church. I don't know if there's other St. John's people in there. Yeah, look at St. John's. And I went to the day to visit my dad's gravesite and have a long chat with him. Took a nice video for my mom, and I'm sure she's watching it and crying it right now. But it was great to go there and watch the Moose Hall show up late. But my dad was always an hour early. And he'd make us get, we're like the first people in the pew. And I'm going, Dad, we really don't got to get here this early. But my dad was always, you got to, yeah, traffic, traffic and Mound. I live in L.A. Nobody talks about miles. They say, so how far is it to get to so-and-so? And I go, it's about an hour and a half. And they go, no, how many miles? It's an hour and a half. Just trust me. It's 20 miles, but it's going to take you that long. So I've always said L.A. has problems, but weather is not one of them. Because I have texted photos back to these other guys here when it's February and it's 82 degrees and I'm in my shorts. They don't text very Christian messages back to me just to let you know. Just to let you know. So it was during the end of my college years. My wife's here and I got to be careful. I was dating a girl named Julie Farmer. And she was modeling and stuff. And I always knew I wanted to act. I started taking some classes in at Morehead State with it, some drama classes mixed in with my marketing advertising degree. I'm a college dropout. I have one quarter to finish, but I'm doing okay. So thought about going back and I went, no. So, but at least I got, you know, 3 years and three quarters of a year in. But she sort of kind of got me involved in that. And for me, it was more just to sort of maybe start doing some commercials, which I did. It was Target, doing Target commercials, that I actually got that all-important SAG card, that Screen Actors Guild card that you have to have when you're in LA. It's like a catch-22. You can't work without it, but you have to get it. You have to have it. It's just a very strange thing. And so I started doing that, and I actually met another girl. You're not listening, are you, Sam? She was also in the same industry, and she said, look, let's go to Dallas, Texas, because there's a lot of stuff happening in Dallas. So I had a good time going down there. I went down there, and I signed with this big agency down there, Kim Dawson Agency, did a lot of commercials as well. But on weekends, I was a bouncer at this club called Confetti's. I just worked Fridays and Saturdays. And what was cool for me was all the Dallas Cowboys came there. There's Too Tall Ed Jones and Randy White and, you know, Tony Dorsett and all these guys. And it was ridiculous, the amount of money I was making at the front door, just on tips. I'm pretty sure I reported everything. And then I went from there to, actually my roommate down there was Jeff Weber, and I think some people remember Jeff Weber. He's one of the best athletes this high school's ever had in Mound. He's my roommate down there. But then I went to Europe, and I was gonna spend 3 months before heading to LA to pursue that actor's dream. And I went to Europe, I went to Milan, Italy, and 3 months turned into 3.5 years. I lived in Munich for 1.5 years, Milan 8 months, Paris 6 months, 3 months in Zurich, 3 months in Hamburg, 3 months. I mean, my mom and dad were giving up on me because they said, I thought you moving to LA. And I said, I'll get there. Well, I finally moved to LA. And what happened in LA happens rarely, I think, to anybody that gets into town in the industry that I chose to pursue. And I booked my very, very first audition on a commercial that sent me to Sydney, Australia. So I wasn't in LA more than a week, and I'm off to Sydney, Australia. And I get down there after 10 days of shooting this commercial. I called my agent in LA, and I said, you know, they tell me my ticket's good for a year. I'm going to stay. They went, what? And I had just moved in. They just had my stuff at one of the assistants up to my booking agent. And I just said, look, I'll pay the rent. I mean, my stuff's in the room. I wasn't barely unpacked. And that turned into a little over 6 months of being in a beautiful city of Sydney, Australia, then Bondi Beach. If you watched the 2000 Olympics and saw the volleyball, that's the beach I lived on. I was right across the street. And it had nothing to do with the fact that the beach was topless, that I stayed. It was there to make money and work as an actor and get better as an actor. So now I'm going on 27, and I finally moved to LA. And it's easy to find, like everybody's an actor in LA. Everybody's an actor. So when I got out there, a lot of it dealt with just what classes I want to be in, what things I want to do. In the last acting class I was in with Roy London, who was a great acting coach, and in that class was Matthew Perry and Brad Pitt and Charlotte Ross and all these other guys. And I remember Brad and I used to, you know, hang out quite a bit together. And I remember seeing Matthew Perry. If you don't know who he is, he was on Friends. He played Chandler on Friends. The first time I saw him act, I hit Brad and I said, that guy should be in a sitcom. He's really good. He's really good. And I see my wife look at me now, because I know she wants me to say this. If I bring up anybody that I get a kiss in a movie, she says, well, I got to do a kissing scene with Brad Pitt. So she's topping me on that all the time. but what'd you say? He was like 2 packs a day. Yeah, he smoked a lot. He just looked in the mirror and said, I'm too good looking. I'm just going to start sucking on cigarettes. You know? Oh, this reminded me of a joke. I probably can't say it. Okay. I'm going to say it anyway. It's not a mean joke. This was years ago with Gary Shandling. If you remember Gary Shandling, the comedian. And he was talking about gay guys on The Tonight Show. And he said, why are all gay guys so good looking? I mean, did they just wake up in the mirror one day and go, I'm not going to waste this on some chick. So, I just thought that was funny. I just tell everybody I'm a flaming heterosexual. Anyway, that class actually opened the door for me for a lot of things. I started getting, he was a really good teacher. And when I left him after 2 years, Roy Lund in this class at Brad Pitt, as I mentioned earlier, when I left the class, told him I was going to leave, Roy said to me, he goes, but Kevin, you're doing so well. You're making these breakthroughs. You got to stay here. And I said, you know, Roy, I'm paying a lot of money each month, and you only worked one day a month. And I got tired of that. I said, you know, I want to get up there and do it. I want to get up there and really, you know, act more. And he said, you learn a lot by watching, too. And I said, you know what? I watch a lot of basketball on TV. I'm not getting any better, you know? I mean, you got to do it. You know, if you want to do it, you got to be part of it out there. So I started doing a Murder, She Wrote episode. I did the Commish, Cheers. I got things just starting to happen. I did a pilot, didn't get picked up. I did another pilot that I got a lead in, didn't get picked up. But it was a different, I could tell that things were starting to roll for me in LA after the first 6 years of getting bounced around. And then along came a show called Lois and Clark. And I got down the last two guys. And I did a big screen test with Terry Hatcher, who went on to do That Desperate Housewives. And Dean Cain was the other guy reading for that part. They told me after like three or four times in meeting with everybody, they called me up and said, you got the part. I flipped out my first lead in a big network show for ABC. I was over the moon. I went out and partied with my manager, my agent, and the next morning they called me and said, you know, they changed their mind. They're going with Dean Cain. Welcome to Hollywood. You get the highs of highs and lows of lows, trust me. But here's the good thing. Dean's been a good friend ever since. He's a great guy. Here's the thing that happened afterwards was about 6 weeks later, I get a call from my agent and say, hey, they're doing these 5 2-hour movies down in New Zealand, and it's called Hercules, The Legendary Journeys. And I started laughing. I said, you know, I'm a big guy, but they're going to want some steroid, 300-pound, no-neck guy. And they said, no. They're looking for a decathlete type athlete, a guy that could be a quarterback on a football team. So I went in and read for it, and I thought, I read pretty good, and I walked out. Because I was at a place in my career now, I said, you know what? Not going to worry about it anymore. Because every actor in Hollywood, trust me, when I first got out there, when you drive home in the 405, you start chewing on your steering wheel and say, why did I do it that way? I should have done it this way. And I just got to a point I'm not going to do that anymore. If they don't pick me, they're lost. They call me back about 2 weeks later. Read again. Whole different group of guys there. Call me back another 2-3 weeks later. Whole another group of guys. They do this 7 times to me. And every time, never new sides, never new script to read, never any direction. And so the 7th time I go in there, everybody from NBC was in there, everybody. And they had probably 20 of the top suits and about 5 of the top skirts. And, you know, and I get up there and I say, guys, you know, you've seen me do this, you've taped this many times, what do you want me to do that's different? And they said, no, we like what you're doing. Did it again. And then one of the women says, she looks around, she goes, okay, Kevin, I'm supposed to ask you to take your shirt off. She says, so I took my shirt off and she went, oh, like this. And and I said, yeah, I'm a lot bigger out of my clothes. And so it got a big laugh. And then Sam Raimi, if you know Sam Raimi, he directed all Spider-Man movies. He's done a lot of these different movies, big time director. He was one of the exec producers. He says, because, you know, I got a little man growth. I got hairy chest and hairy, but not like Robin Williams hairy, but, you know, some there. And he says, would you be willing to, you know, if you get the part, to wax your body? And I said, oh, I'm sorry. I thought you wanted a man for this role. I was at that place. So I left. I got a guest spot on The Commish with Michael Chiklis. You remember that show? It was a Stephen Cannell show. So I go up to Vancouver, Canada to shoot this. It's September 24th, which happens to be my birthday. I get a call to call my manager. Call her up and she says, you got the part. I went, what? She goes, you're Hercules. And I went back on set and I looked at Michael Chiklis, who had been giving me a hard time the whole time. He's a nice guy, but he likes to goof around on the set. And I said, no screwing around with me now. I am officially half God. And I spent the next couple months training, putting on another 10 pounds of muscle and just working out with this wonderful, one of Bruce Lee's ex-students. And I went to New Zealand. And it was amazing. I mean, the first year was 5 tour movies. That's all the show was supposed to be. I knew by the 2nd movie they're going to make it a series. I told my manager and nobody else, and I said, you watch, I'm going to make it a series. But I got to work a whole year with Anthony Quinn. And it was amazing. I mean, seriously, here's a guy that did 270-some movies, nominated 6 times for Academy Awards, 2 wins. and he always wanted to play Zeus. He was 78 years old at the time. He passed at 86. We kept in touch until he passed away. Great guy, great stories. We went to dinner all the time, and I remember the first time I introduced him to Mom and Dad and Henderson. He was out there with his art exhibit at one of the casinos, and he comes up to my mom, puts his arm around her, and he says, "I'm his other Padre, just so you know." And to this day, they still have up on their fridge a photo of my mom and dad with Anthony Quinn, which is just was really cool. Sure enough, by the third movie, they called him and said, we're going to make it a series. And I don't know who all watched it in here, but I got to tell you, that show by the third season passed Baywatch as the most watched TV show in the world, which is, you know, being part of that from my little town of Mound here, it is so cool for me. I was so blessed doing that in New Zealand. If you've never been, do yourself a favor. It is a beautiful country. The people are wonderful, and it was an amazing experience for me to be part of that. And we are into season four, near the end of season four. And every 2 weeks, they sent down, my wife hates this, every 2 weeks, they sent down a beautiful woman for me to work with. It was kind of cool. And lo and behold, Sam Jenkins, her maiden name, comes down to be on the show. And we were meeting each other for the first time. There was a volcano that had erupted in the North Island, so they'd cancel flights for like 24 hours, 48 hours, whatever it was. And I worked 16 to 17 hours door to door. It was really long days in the set. That included lifting weights all the time. Where are you going? That's my son. Where the heck do you think you're going? He's heard me speak before. So anyway, we had to go. We always would read with all the cast members before the next show started. And she had a mission. She had the lead as the guest lead in the show. So the director, Charlie Siebert, wanted us to meet at his apartment. So we get there, and you know, I was tired from a long day on the set. It was 14 hours a day, and I'd already read the script to everybody else. I said, I'm going to do this. And then I see her and went, oh. And I went to shake her hand, and instead of that, she gave me a hug. And I went, or like a kiss, double European kiss. I went, oh, okay, we're in one of those things. All right, Hollywood. And I was already kind of smitten. My brother Tom was down there with his son Craig at that same time. And the next day on the set, we did the very first, was it the next day on the set or 2 days later? Next day, right away. Our very first scene was the kissing scene at the end of the movie. Because what happens is, in case after 10 days of shooting each other, they don't want the people that are supposed to be in love hating each other, because actors can be annoying. And she thought maybe I was a big egotistical jerk. And so we get on the set, and I know I'm going to mix this up a little bit, so don't correct me, but it's still funny. it's wrong already. But I said to her, I looked at her, I said, well, Sam, how are we going to make this work? She says, what? And I said, well, we got like a little bit of a water hazard between us called the Pacific Ocean. I mean, you know, how are we going to work this out? And she starts laughing. She says, first of all, I don't date actors. And I don't date guys with long hair. And I said, well, right now I'm making a pretty good living with the long hair. And so before the kissing scene, I walked over to her and I said, so, how, you know, maybe we should practice this kissing scene before it starts. And she goes, oh, sure, Kevin. Yeah, sure. Annie, do you have any mints? Because Annie was my makeup artist, and she has everything. And she goes, yes. And she started, all the makeup artists, all eight of them on set started throwing around mints and stuff like that. And then Sam says, oh, no, it's not for me. It's for Kevin. So I went touche. And she played a princess on the show. And I did one more episode after that episode. Then I left for Croatia and Bratislava, Slovakia to shoot a movie called Kull the Conqueror, which was the prequel of Conan the Barbarian. Kull is the father of Conan. So even though Arnold's older than me, apparently I'm his dad. And I invited Sam over. And we had only known each other 2 weeks, maybe. And my dad was over at the same time. And my dad hugged her. My dad doesn't hug anybody. I introduced him. He hugged her right away. And I was like, what is going on? And I don't know, we kept in touch. He was doing a show called Chicago Hope at that time. And we just, it was funny, you left, and I get a call from Universal saying, we have this three-show arc we want to do. And we thought the chemistry between you and Sam Jenkins was pretty good. Did you like her? Was she okay? And I was like, yeah, she's all right. So, and I called up right away, and I said, you're coming down for like 2 months to do the next three episodes. And that kind of sealed the deal for us. And we got engaged fairly quickly and married up pretty much the year after we got engaged. But I got to pop down to the fifth season. We know each other for about a year at this point. And it was the fifth season of Hercules. Near the last couple months of it, I started having these pains in my shoulder. Couldn't figure out what was going on. And these three fingers on this hand kept getting more cold and more numb. And I was doing most of my own stunts. I was working out, you know, and I grew up playing sports and all that stuff. So you kind of go, ah, whatever. And because we're doing three fight scenes every episode. And my ego, I wanted to do them. I was dumb enough to want to do them all the time, but I had fun doing my great stunt guys that made me look like I was still a stud. So they were killing me and getting more numb. And I called my doctor back in LA and I told him what's going on. He said, you may have smashed your ulnar nerve. Hockey players at all time. And it's that feeling. It can take months to heal. And I said, okay, I blew it off. I come back home to do publicity on Call the Conqueror. I fly to New York, did Letterman, a couple other shows, and it was just killing me. I go up to Boston to do some more TV and radio stuff. This time my arm felt like it was falling off. So they send a doctor to my hotel room. Dr. Carlson is here, correct? This guy's name was Dr. Dye. D-Y-E. I mean, seriously. Take somebody else's name, you know? You're a doctor, you know? And, but he's the one who actually found out. He said, I think it's something cardiovascular. You really need to get this checked out. So I get back to LA, I see my doctor. He's feeling around, he finds a lump in my shoulder. And I could see his face. I could see he said, you know, Kevin, I want to do a biopsy on this. And that freaked me out, because I thought, you know what? I'm healthy, I'm working every day, I'm eating, I'm not drinking, I'm not smoking, nothing. It sort of freaked me out. And then I go, the same day before I set up the biopsy, I went to see my chiropractor. And I'm laying on the table, my eyes are closed, he's working around on my shoulder, he says, yeah, I got something going on here. As I lay there, I heard a voice say, don't let him crack your neck. I opened my eyes, I looked up at him, I said, do you say something? He goes, I didn't say anything. I closed my eyes again, don't let him crack your neck. It's louder, it's more urgent. It sort of freaked me out. And I'm thinking, why would he crack my neck? He's never cracked my neck, because in 8 years, of seeing this guy, he knows I don't like my neck cracked. You can crack anything in my body, leave my neck alone. And while I'm arguing with his voice, boom, he cracks my neck. And what had happened was there was an aneurysm in my left subclavicle that had been spitting out blood clots all these months and cutting off suffocating the blood flow in these fingers. Well, that crack, it was so close to the artery leading into the brain, it sent three clots into my brain. I suffered three strokes. So I went from a guy that was in his mid-30s and probably in better shape than most guys in their 20s to a guy that couldn't even balance himself or walk. And I spent the next, I had to drop out of a movie I was about to do. I remember Sam taking me to the hospital. It was the same day the Princess Di died. And I remember looking at this beautiful September blue sky, and I said to myself, I didn't say it to her at the time, I said to myself, I'm gonna die today. And what amazed me is how calm I was about it. But I always had wanted to get married. I wanted to have kids. I always thought this career was going to keep on going. So it was a weird step for me to sit there and have to handle. And I was in ICU for a long time. And what they did is they went through, this is for the doctors, they did an angio and put a platinum coil. And they were the aneurysms. Thank God they did that. But the three strokes, I had two went to my balance center, one went to my vision. I still have a 10% loss in both eyes. But I spent the next 4 months just learning how to balance and learn how to walk again. And not only was it tough physically, it was tough mentally on me as well. I suffered all kinds of different things with vertigo and dizzy spells and panic anxiety attacks. I had all these things, migraines, things that had never happened to me before. But it was a long road for me. I went back to New Zealand where we got married 4 months. We kept the date. I wanted to move the date because I wasn't doing too well. And Mark and John came out to the wedding, but it was tough to do it. But one of the neurologists said, "Don't put your life on hold," which I thought was a great thing to hear from somebody. because a lot of us do that. We get held back in our lives in a lot of things, and I think fear is one of the biggest factors that hold any of us back from having the success that we should all have. But we did have the marriage, and I went down there, and I went from a 14-hour day to 1 hour a day, and then a month later it was 2 hours. It was just a slow build-up because, you know, it's, the show's called Hercules. We're the most watched show in the world. They have me 2 years on the contract left, and let's face it, it's hard to do a show called Hercules without Hercules. So they did what they could to keep the show going, and I was grateful for it because it gave me this light at the end of a very long and dark tunnel for me. It gave me hope, and it gave me a drive to get better. But it took me 3 full years to actually get better. And a lot of that was the help from Sam, because she's Pittsburgh and New York, and she's a lot tougher than I am. And she beat me up every time I felt sorry for myself. She said, you know, stop it. This happened to you. And, you know, it was a great push to get there. And she bugged me for a long time to write this book. And she did a lot of help in writing the book for me. I have a book out now called True Strength. And I know some of you have it, told me you had it. And it's been amazing. It came out years after. It's only been out for like three and a half years now. And I didn't want to do it. I didn't want to expose myself to people that way, but it's been incredible. I do a lot of these Comic-Con shows. I do a lot of traveling. I get stopped by people all the time, you know, telling me about the book and telling them they've had their stroke survivors, their cancer survivors, their car crash survivors, heart attack, whatever it may be. And they say the book has motivated them to stop feeling sorry for themselves. So it was huge that we did this book, because it's been amazing. It's been like a godsend for me, and it was actually very therapeutic for me to do it. I want to bounce around a little bit more. I'm going to bounce forward again. So after we finished those last couple seasons of Hercules in New Zealand, I got a call from Universal, and they wanted to do another seasons 8, 9, and 10. But I got a call right at the same time by Majel Roddenberry. Now, I think some of you might know that last name. I'm a huge Star Trek fan. I think I've seen every one of those episodes. In college, after all my studying, I would watch at night, 10:30 Twilight Zone, then 11 o'clock, it was Star Trek. And if we weren't listening to REO Speedwagon or Styx. And maybe having a beer. But she called me and said, my husband wrote this show in 1969 after Star Trek finished. It's called Andromeda. And I just said, I'm in. I didn't see anything yet. And we got picked up for a 5-year run. And I shot. And then I went from New Zealand to Vancouver, British Columbia. And that was amazing. I love living up there. So I had 12 straight years of these wonderful shows and wonderful stories. And when Andromeda finished, I had come up with an idea along with my manager I've been doing a lot of sitcoms in my breaks. I don't know if you saw, I did 2 and a Half Men, I've done Darman Greg, Just Shoot Me, According to Jim. I mean, I love doing the live sitcom because you're up in front of about 200 people. You just start on a Monday and boom, Friday you're putting on this little play and it's just a hoot. And so I came up with this idea for this, I thought about like Brett Favre at the end of his career. It's called Bobby Cannon. If you want, you can check it out. The full episode is on iTunes, not iTunes, on the internet. It's out there, YouTube or something, yeah. It's called Bobby Cannon. And we hired Barry Kemp to write it. You may not know Barry Kemp's name, but you know his work. He was the head writer on Taxi. He created the Newhart series, the second one in the Mountain. And he created a little show called Coach with Craig T. Nelson, he was a Minnesota college football coach. And he wrote an amazing pilot. And we had the crowd, the live audience when we taped that night went nuts for it. They loved it. They put out 28 new pilots that year for ABC. We tested number one in every single market. And the president, the then president of ABC, decided not to pick the show up. And it killed me. Because I remember USA did a big spread on me saying, Kevin Sorbo from Hercules to, from Herc to Kirk, is he now the new king of comedy? Which I thought was awesome. They have this big spread. Well, I was excited. We actually flew to New York for the upfronts, and they told me the next day that they were going to cancel the show and said, could you please just get out of the hotel so we don't have to pay for another day? Yes. So welcome to a nice world of Hollywood once again. And it killed me because it was a very funny show. It was like a Brett Favre at the end of his career. He's done everything, and it's NFL draft day. And we're sitting there in my bar called Cannons on Michigan Avenue. We had Trey Wingo, who does the actual draft day for ESPN, on the television saying, you know, I figured they'd get me another offensive lineman to protect me. They draft a quarterback from Texas A&M, and I realized, oh, my God, my days are numbered. That for my potential love interest on the show, they had Kate Walsh. You guys may have saw her in Private Practice for many years. Rocky Carroll's my sports agent. He's been on NCIS for the last 7-8 years. We had a really good cast, and it kills me to this day. And what happens is they buy it from you and hold on to it for 5 years, so they just let it die somewhere else. So check it out. It was, to me, it was like, that was like, that's like an actor's dream to get something like that. So unfortunately it didn't happen, but you know, what are you going to do? God's not dead. We'll get to that. Yes. 45 movies. Last 10 years, and so the last 10 years since that thing got picked up, I've done about 45 movies now. It's been a good mixture of stuff. Everything from a serial killer to a pastor, so I've kind of covered it all. I did make a movie, not the same movie. I did make a movie that I finally told my mom. I said, this one you can't see. So this is, it's just more of a psychological thriller, but it was a creepy character to play, but I had fun. It was fun. Actually, I got to say, we were shot in Shreveport, that movie. Remember that? We shot in Shreveport. And I'm with my boys, and we're grocery shopping at the Target or the Walmart there or something, and this couple walks up to me. And he says, what the hell are you doing in Shreveport? I looked at him, I said, oh, well, I'm shooting a movie. He goes, in Shreveport? And I said, yes, we're shooting a movie. Son, we're the armpit of America. And his wife smacks him. She goes, we live here. He goes, I know, but it's still the armpit of America. You're probably too young to remember. That was like that was like 5 years ago already, wasn't it? It was funny. But it's been, like I said, a mixed bag of things. And I started doing some of the faith-based movies here. And I always wanted to, but I never really saw a script come my way that I liked. And then a script came to me 5 years ago called What If? If you haven't seen it, I highly recommend it. It's on Netflix. It's on Amazon. You can get it anywhere. And it was, the director was Dallas Jenkins. And Dallas Jenkins' father is Jerry Jenkins. If you know him, he wrote the Left Behind series of books, which, by the way, I just signed on to the next two Left Behind series leads. So I'm very excited for that because, thank you. Apparently, a lot of crowd out there didn't trust Nick Cage as a Christian in the last one, so it didn't do too well. So the guys from Toronto, it's called Cloud Nine, came down and I had a meeting with them in Beverly Hills, and so we're doing the next two. But what if was a really, I love that movie, and it was just it was really neat to be part of that. We shot that in Michigan, thank God, in the summertime, and a number of you come to me already and said how much you love this other movie I'm about to mention, God's Not Dead. And God's Not Dead. You can clap for that one. That was a good one. I played an atheist college professor. And this is going on quite a bit in our universities, if you don't know about it. Because even at the end of the movie, they show 28 court cases where this is going on. And I've seen 3 more court cases just on the internet recently. In Santa Barbara and Florida, and I think the one in Tennessee, where students were being failed in their philosophy class just because they believed in God. And the college professors did not. And we're not sending our kids and spending this much money to send them to college for those reasons. And it's amazing to me because there's a huge group out there that screams for tolerance, yet they have none. And Hollywood does the same thing with freedom of speech. They fight to the death for freedom of speech, but only if you agree with what they say. And I definitely fight back with that. I'm kind of sick of it. And if it wasn't, and because I'm very vocal about it, it's actually hurt my career in Hollywood. I've been very lucky in the independent world that I'm able to keep working. But God's Not Dead. I get stopped all the time when I travel by people, and it's always like 70% it's Hercules, 30% Andromeda. It's now 80% God's Not Dead. I get stopped all the time. It's amazing. No, it is. It's amazing. In that little movie, no studio wanted to be the distributor in it. Nobody. We went around, shopped it everywhere. I know the guys down in Scottsdale. It's called Pure Flix that do these movies, and they found a distribution company, independent distribution company. This movie started in 740 screens, finished number 2 with a per screen average the first weekend out at $11,000 per screen. It was only about $1,000 behind the new X-Men movie last year, which was a $280 million budget. We were a $2 million budget. They bumped it to 1,400 screens. Finished number 2 again. They bumped it to 2,000 screens. I know a lot of you guys don't know the way Hollywood works, but that's unheard of. especially for independent movie. It stayed in theaters for almost 4 months, and around the world, counting theatrical, DVD sales, and merchandising, they're $140 million on a $2 million movie. And I really wish I owned the back end on that thing. So, because next time they come to me, Sam, my wife actually gave me a good thing to say about, you know, how do you go from playing, you know, if you're a Christian in real life, how do you play an atheist? And I just tell people, like, well, I think of a Christian, and I just take away all reason and accountability. So that's how that works. So, but brought up Hollywood, you know, politics and religion, two things that are not controversial to anybody, apparently. But The God's Not Dead, obviously, was huge for me. I shot 6 more movies last year. 2 of them just came out now. One's called The Secret Handshake, a great family comedy. It's a really nice family show. It was written and directed by Howie Klausner. You may not know his name, but you know his work. And one of his famous movies he wrote was called Space Cowboys with Tommy Lee Jones, Clint Eastwood, and James Garner. And great guy. We shot that in Nashville. Sam's kind of thrown her hat in the ring again, acting more. We have a movie out right now called Hope Bridge. And Hope Bridge deals with teen suicide. It's a heavy subject matter, but there's hope and bridge in the title, so it should show you there's a positive look at this. I just finished a movie called Caged. Caged deals with human trafficking. I was in Baton Rouge, Louisiana last year, and Governor Bobby Jindal was in the movie with us because it's one of his big topics. It's one of the biggest things that's happening in Louisiana. So I got to do a couple scenes with him. He invited me to his... to the governor's mansion, and I'm going to say yes, that's cool. And I went there, and he had a whole slew of these Baptist ministers there. And he asked me if I'd say a few words, kind of out of the blue. I didn't realize I have to talk. So I said, okay, I'm not Baptist, I'm a Christian. So as I talk, you don't have to feel the need to talk back to me unless you want to. You know, can I get an amen? You know, so. But, so that's out right now, and that's out in the fall. I'm leaving tomorrow morning early for the 700 Club in Norfolk, Virginia, then heading up to New York City. I have another movie coming out now called Gallows Road, which is a modern-day faith-based Western that I shot in Fort Worth. So if you shoot in Fort Worth, it better be a Western. And so, and Sam came up with a great idea. We sat around talking. This is a while ago. I said, you know, you look at Touched by an Angel. Look at Highway to Heaven. Seventh Heaven. These shows all ran like 8, 9, 10 years. Nothing on TV like that in the last 12 years until recently with Mark Burnett's The Bible, the AD series. And it did really well, much to the chagrin of NBC and other networks. But it opened their eyes a little bit more, and they're all opening eyes a little bit more now, seeing what's going on. That, see, you have Hollywood, New York City, and they call all the states in between flyover states. I go, yeah, there are people living in those states that have morals, have values, want their kids to have values. I mean, my kids were growing up on Dream of Jeannie, Brady Bunch, I Love Lucy, I mean, shows that I grew up with. I mean, because, you know, primetime TV is really not for kids anymore. But, you know, the value system has changed in America. And I think the silent majority is starting to stand up and fight back just a little bit more now. But the idea she came up with when I talked about those shows was, I can't give the idea, but I want to tell you, it's a miracle that we sold this pilot to NBC, and we hope to shoot it this year. It is not touched by an angel, it's more like punched by an angel. So there's a harder edge to it, but it ties in with the military, it ties in with God, it ties in with my character, and it's a wonderful, so. But for those who pray, please pray that it gets picked up. We'll shoot it later in the year or the first next year. And it's a really cool idea. It's a really cool show. Looking forward to making that happen. But I leave, like I said, I'm doing the press on this movie called Gallows Road. We can't get on the Today Show with it. We can't get on mainstream. The only shows that have us on cable is Fox. They're the only ones that talk about God. If some of you saw my movie, Soul Surfer, I was in Soul Surfer, Dennis Quaid and Helen Hunt, the story of Bethany Hamilton. Sony Studios was nervous about mentioning Jesus. Shh, don't talk, you can't say that. And I actually said to the top Sony guys who were on set, I said, so, if I use it as a swear word, that's okay, right? Oh yeah, that's fine. Seriously. But if you use it in a way that promotes love and all that, you can't do that. And I've talked about this before. You look at the Grammy Awards, there's some really good Christian musicians out there and rock music and stuff. They give their Grammys behind closed doors. But then if you watch the Grammys, you know what I'm talking about and some of the stuff you've seen in the live acts. It's like a soft porn exhibit. You know, it's kind of weird that they don't want that out there. So, you know, I'm just fighting the fight with that. I'm certainly not perfect, but it's been an interesting ride within that industry, and I've been very fortunate to keep on going. And to wrap it up a little bit, it's so cool to come back home here because my roots are here. I get a lot of nice compliments from people I work with out there, and I say, you know what, it's because where I grew up, and I know that. I tell people I'm a 13-year overnight success, you know, so it didn't happen overnight for me. There was a lot of bumps and bruises, but as I said, I was very fortunate in Hollywood to work right away and not have to work another job, because not many actors can say that when they go out to that city. And it's for me, it's like people like you and coming back home, and I always come back here. When I can. My kids love it. They're just like, Dad, let's get a house here. And I said, yeah, you wait till February. We'll talk then, you know. But would I like a summer lake on the Lake Minnetonka? Damn right I would. So, but anyway, guys, thank God. Bless you all, and thank God for that. You all came on. I really appreciate the time. I wish I could have talked to every single table, but this side took off all the time. But thank you all, guys. I appreciate it. Thanks.